Right, ladies and gentlemen, it is time to rock and roll. It is Wednesday. We've survived at least half the week. Welcome, everyone. We are live from the bunker, and we are broadcasting to both YouTube and Facebook. The comments and the chats are open. If you are not live with us, if you're Memorex, you can still leave us a comment and share your thoughts. You can send us an email, livefromthebunker@scififorme.com. And you can join us on all of the social media accounts. We're pretty much everywhere you are. And if you are of a mind to listen to us by podcast, we are on a number of players: iHeartRadio, Amazon Music, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Double Twitch, Stitcher, TuneIn, Pocket Casts. Get all of that in. Oh, my goodness gracious. All right, we do also have a newsletter. I want to encourage you to sign up for that. Just in case any of the social medias kind of go sideways. We haven't been canceled yet. We've got to try harder, I guess. And just to let people know, we do have something I'd like to share with you here real quick. Our friend Drunk3PO is going to be having a charity stream tonight to raise money for Operation Underground Railroad. They battle child trafficking, and that is tonight at 7 p.m. Eastern. So just want to share that with you real quick. And let me turn this one thing off. And that's all the stuff that I've got tonight, or not tonight, rather, Friday at 4 p.m. Central. We're going to do a brand new tartar sauce. We're going to do a different time. It's a 5 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Central. They're going to be discussing Doctor Who. And in this particular conversation, they're talking about the monsters that are essentially played out. We've had enough. Thank you. All right. Now, all that out of the way. So now, let's bring in our guest, editor and publisher at Baen Books, Toni Weisskopf, joins us today. Good afternoon. Hi.
Hey, everybody. I will say we also have with us Smokey the Cat.
Well, welcome, Smokey. So, yes. I'm looking at some of these different interviews with you, and a lot of them touch on the anthropology. You started off, you're a student of anthropology of all things, and now you're editing science fiction. And I've seen you made the comment a couple of places how they're very much related in a way. So how did you go from one to the other? What was your path?
Well, I have to say that the initial path when I went into college is that I thought I was going to be going to medieval history, I discovered somewhere about midway through my sophomore year that I was spending all my time on science fiction, the science fiction club, teaching science fiction classes, doing science fiction fanzines, arranging science fiction speakers to come to college. And a friend of mine sat me down, looked at me and said, "You know, you're going into publishing, right?" And I was like, "No, I hadn't known that, but you're right. That's exactly what I'm going to do." And so after that, I needed a major. And I loved anthropology. Anthropology was great fun. So it was less that I went from anthropology to science fiction and more that I had to graduate. And anthropology was my path to graduation. And medieval history was not going to be my path. As it turned out, at Oberlin College at the time, the person in the history department who specialized in medieval history was interested in medieval philosophy, which is medieval Christian philosophy, mm-hmm. which is literally the philosophers arguing the number of angels on the head of a pin. It is the least interesting part of medieval history that you could possibly go for. And I include statistics on famine in this. Okay. So it was not going to be for me, medieval history at Oberlin College at the time.
Right.
But the anthropology was great fun. I really enjoyed it.
Well, and I've seen you make the point that your background in anthropology, you know, when you look at all of the different different ways that science fiction examines not just the human condition, but you're creating out of whole cloth other civilizations, other cultures, other histories, and that sort of thing. I never actually made that connection before when I was reading all of this. I was like, you know, that actually does make a certain amount of sense because in your world building, you have to, it's all of those details. It's how many loads of laundry did they do in a day? And it's that minutia that really adds depth into the world building and the believability. And it brings to mind, Anne McCaffrey's world building on Pern. Because you've got to create this entire culture with, how did we get from this point back here, point A, to point M, where we are in our current history? So it's something probably worth looking at for a number of other people. Have you had conversations when you're editing other authors' books? How much does this come up in conversation in terms of adding depth to the world building?
It does. It really does. Anthropology does give you good cultural anthropology, which is what I was studying. Really does give you that broad brush understanding of human universals and human systems. This doesn't happen so much with authors that are in our stable, because those guys and ladies, I'm from New York, so guys is everybody, right?
Right.
They're very, very good at what they do. But certainly when I'm doing workshops or talking with newer writers, believability is a huge part of what it is that I talk about. And this is for on the fantasy side as well. Your systems have to hold together. You have to, the reader has to believe that your world is real to be able to get that suspension of disbelief and to be able to fall into the story that you're telling them. And that can be wild and crazy and as far futuristic and as, fantasy magic filled as you want, but you still have to, you can't have that speed bump for the reader. You can't have that, oh, that's not how that works. Or it's like, oh, people don't do that. You have to be able to get them there.
Right. A lot of time, we've interviewed a number of authors who have come through here, and we've talked to comic book creators and artists and that sort of thing. Haven't really had a whole lot of conversations with editors, because in the publishing world, from the outside looking in, people will look at, they'll pick up a book and they might or might not recognize the author's name, but there's really, I don't think, much of a layman's understanding. People know that there are editors that exist, but not exactly what the editor does. And your name in genre circles, especially, your name is fairly well known. You're highly regarded. I've seen nothing but good comments about you in the main. So for the people who don't quite understand, what exactly does an editor do versus what a copy editor does? Because I know there's a distinction there.
Well, there is. There's a bunch of different levels of editors. And it also depends really not only on the author, but the work that you have in front of you. So an acquisitions editor, if they get in a perfect short story or a perfect novel, what they do is nothing. Nothing. You don't mess with it. That's very hard to do, by the way. A different author or different even work by an author that you're familiar with might require something different. Sometimes it's a conversation just to get ideas flowing. Sometimes it's a conversation when an author is, has come to a bump in their road and they're not really sure which solution is best or which way to go or what to concentrate on. Sometimes the developmental editor hat is comes after the story has been delivered. And you, from your remove from the author, are able to say, you know what, the pacing in the second chapter or the second section isn't quite fast enough, or you rush through the ending. That happens a lot. You rush through the ending, the reader needs a little more there because this is a, you know, this is an important part. So we need to see more on the page. We know it was up here,
Yeah. But
we're not seeing enough of it on the page. So it really, there's a lot of different things that a developmental editor can do. A copy editor is in particular looking more for line to line sorts of issues. Issues of grammar, of continuity, making sure that the gray cat who is annoying you by sitting right there, stepping on your laptop, is still a gray cat at the end of the interview, unless there's been some magic and it's okay that they're blue, right?
It could be a Heinlein
magic,
cat.
We need to see the magic happen.
That's right.
All right, sorry about that. Make sure that this is not the caregiver, and it's not. I have my daughter is with caregivers right now. So in case of emergency, I need to know that. So thank you, audience.
So, and speaking of, we've got Sci-Fi Snob in the chat asking any suggestions for aspiring editors. So if you've got somebody who wants to become an acquisitions editor, for example, or a main line editor, how would one go about doing that? Because that's not just, oh, I think I'm going to write a book today, and I just get in front of the keyboard and start going. Editors, you've right. got to actually have an in somewhere, I would expect.
You do, and because we are in a charmingly interesting time,
I like how you put that.
things have changed from when I got in the business. There's a lot of independent writers out there hiring independent editors. So you can, in fact, just set out your shingle and say, "Hey, I'm an editor." But doing an internship with a larger publisher is a good way to go. Volunteering for a semi-pro magazine to look at their slush pile is another way to go, and also to test your tolerance for reading and to be able to test your taste to see if in fact what it is that you choose are things that other people also like. So internships are probably the best way to get started. We at Baen do have an internship, and if you're in college, you can get college credit for our unpaid internships. We also will buy you lunch and give you lots of free books. So that's our plug for Baen Books right there.
So when you're teaching somebody this, it almost seems to me, because in most industries, you've either got it or you don't. There's a skill set that comes with it and a certain amount of talent, and I would expect maybe just a little bit of just gut instinct on knowing what makes a good story, knowing what's going to sell, what's not going to sell. How do you teach somebody that? And what does somebody need to know going in? What makes a good story? And I imagine the criteria for Baen is different than it would be at Tor or Random House or wherever. Everybody's got different ideas on what works and what doesn't. So how do you figure that part out? You know, you talk about, you know, developing a tolerance for reading and seeing if this is your thing. But once you decide it's your thing, where's that nugget of knowledge that says, aha, this is going to be a best-selling book. This one is going to sell copies. And I don't mean New York Times bestseller. I mean actually selling copies off the shelf and making money for the publisher and the author.
Well, I tell you what, if I had the exact formula for that, I would be bottling that up and selling it. The answer is that editing is an apprenticeship kind of an education, and you don't know until you've had the chance to acquire. As with writers, when writers are looking to sell to traditional publishers, they're going to look and see, they're going to go to their bookshelves, they're going to look in the bookstores, and they're going to say, all right, who publishes the kind of thing it is that I do? Well, same if you're, you know, if you want to get into editing. Who is it who publishes the kind of thing that I'm reading and that I enjoy and that I think I would be good at picking out? Being able to tell the difference between something that's okay and something that's going to be appealing to a whole, to a larger mass audience. It's a trial and error kind of thing. There isn't a magic formula.
In terms of names that I recognize for editors, there's you, there's Ellen Datlow. Not too many names that are just out there that everybody goes, oh, I know who that is. Yeah. How does somebody find an editor to apprentice under? Every now and again, the author will mention an editor in the foreword of the book, the acknowledgments. But is there some best way of finding that entry point? If you're looking for an apprenticeship or you're looking for an internship, is it just contact the publisher, or are we looking for direct contact with an editor? Is there a proper path for this?
As long ago as, you know, a year ago, I would have said, go to science fiction conventions, make yourself known, meet, hang out in the bar and, go to panels to see who's simpatico, who who has the kind of philosophy and personality that you would like to work with. Going through the publishing houses themselves is a way to do it. Back in my day, I flooded the science fiction world with my resume, and two stuck. One of them was Baen, and the other was Locus. Locus back in the day, and hired a lot of editorial assistants, and it was a good way to to get into the business. If you're willing to start off on the ground floor, being an editorial assistant somewhere. Is another good way to go. There's not a whole lot of science fiction lines left at traditional publishers. And for most of them, you have to, again, a year ago, I would have said you have to live in New York to do that. Right. Now, who knows? There's so much telecommuting that, maybe you don't. The path is not an easy one.
You mentioned going to panels and being simpatico philosophically and that sort of thing raises the ugly specter of the cancel culture. If you don't agree with us for fill in the blank, then we're not going to take a look at you. And we've seen a number of examples, especially in the YA market, where authors essentially get bullied into either pulling their book altogether or changing it to satisfy some whatever gender identity politics type, politically correct culture of the day thing. Have you noticed in traditional publishing, now self-publishing, you go publish whatever you want. In self-publishing, that's not a problem. But in traditional publishing, how much of an issue do you think it's been? Because you look at what Baen publishes, you look at what Tor publishes, and there's a lot of criticism back and forth about various different things that have gotten published and the question why. Is this a problem in traditional publishing right now, or has this been just kind of overblown because the internet is full of loud, noisy, mean junior high girls?
Certainly that. All I can speak is for us, sure. Right, is for Baen. I don't know if it's been a problem for the traditional publishers. What I can tell you is that there are people who used to be published by those other publishers who are now looking for other publishers. And there are some people who we've been able to pick up. Is it a problem for their bottom line? I honestly can't tell you. The traditional publishers, I know Tor does, I don't know if the other publishing lines do, have sensitivity readers who are part of the editorial process. We don't have that at Baen. Our editorial process is very streamlined. This can sometimes mean that there's a bottleneck because I have to approve all acquisitions. But your work is not going to be sent to a sensitivity editor. If that's something that you don't agree with, you think that things should be sent to a sensitivity editor, then, you know, you shouldn't, you know, you're not going to want to work at Baen. If you think they don't, then maybe you should consider, send us your resume. We do have volunteer editorial positions as well, not just internships. So, I don't know how they make money. All I know is how I make money.
Right. Now, when
I make money by publishing good stories, you know, regardless of who the writer is, what their editorial, you know, what their political positions are, what they have between their legs, what color their hair is. I don't care about any of that. All I care about is, do they have a good story to tell me? Right. And you know, that's how we make our money.
So let me ask you, when you have somebody who comes in and they're starting out, and today's climate, everybody's got a chip on their shoulder. How do you tell people, leave your personal sensitivities at the door? We are here to publish books, and we're here to put out the best product we can. Whether you agree with the author or not, you're looking at the craft of the book. Do you have to do a lot of those conversations, or is it just kind of a given in the environment that Baen has?
We haven't had to. We are now starting to. I'm not trying to offend any of our freelancers or make them work on projects that they're not happy with. On the other hand, you know, I expect people to be professional. There's a line you walk there. I mean, we at Baen, we publish when we were accused of being putting the thumb on the scale for one particular political point of view, I went back and looked at the professed positions of our authors online. Mm-hmm. And for those that expressed political opinions, which was about 2/3 of them, about half of those were conservative libertarian, and about half of those were liberal Democrat. And about 1/3 didn't say anything, so we had no idea what their positions are.
Right.
So, which I think accurately reflects the population of the United States. So I think, and I think that's probably true of our freelancers as well. Again, it's not a question that I ask them. I don't care what their positions are.
Right.
What I need to know is, can you deliver me that ad in time? Can you give me that painting? Can you copy edit that manuscript? These are the things that I care about. For the most part, we haven't had that problem.
Have you found that you've had to monitor your own filters at all, even maybe more so than in the past, over the last 2, 3, 4, 5, when was 2015, I guess, is when the whole thing kind of imploded with the Yugos. Have you found yourself fighting those biases of your own and say, you know, I got to put that aside. I'm reading X and So's book. I'm reading it for the book. Not to put you on the spot,
No, I really haven't. I mean, you know, my method is still my method. I mean, you know, I read the book for, you know, as the book, or read the story as the story. We do publish collections and anthologies as well as novels, of course. And we publish short stories on our website and nonfiction on the website and so on. I don't think I have to filter myself. I do try to, moderate my social media posts and try to live up to the philosophy of Baen's bar, right, which is no hitting.
Right, sure.
So which is to say, no ad hominem attacks. So I will respond to And again, I try not to do too much of this, but if I make a political post or if I make a political response, it will be about policy, not people. Okay. Sure. Policy, not personalities. I think that's a reasonable way for people to be. Do I proscribe that from my authors? No, that's not my job. It's not my job to police their speech in any way, shape, or form. My job is to publish books, which is what I do.
Now, the social media, I had a conversation with Anne Crispin before she passed away. I had a chance to interview her for her Pirates of the Caribbean book. And we were talking about the fact that authors nowadays have a lot more of the weight of marketing on their shoulders. Publishers are not doing as much internally to promote books. The authors are expected to do their part, and it seems like it's more now than it used to be. But with social media being a part of that mix, how do you separate? And I know every author, it's their own personal account, and you know they do whatever they want to with it, but when you have someone who is associated with a brand, whether it's Baen Books, Star Wars, Star Trek, Doctor Who, Planned Parenthood, whoever, if you have somebody that is so closely tied to a thing, how hard is it to separate the author from the work if the author is being a nasty person on social media? Doesn't that do harm to the sales for the publisher?
Well, yeah, I mean, you have to remember that, you know, unless we are talking some huge franchise like Star Wars or Star Trek, we're talking teeny tiny populations, right? So we're talking Tempest and Teacups for the most part. The science fiction community, quote unquote, is teeny tiny compared to the science fiction buying public. Okay. So that whatever kinds of upsets there are in the community, the effect on the bottom line is not nearly the effect that the people in the community think it is. So there's that. But in general, do I think it's a good idea to be unprofessional online? Yeah, I do. Being a professional jerk, people have made a career out of it. Harlan Ellison was one, who was really, really good at invective. He was not really, really good at meeting deadlines or working with publishers. He did what he did. He did him. So, and I think that's basically what it comes down to, is that you as the reader, you as the author, you as the person who is posting on social media, have to decide for yourself what it is that you're comfortable with.
You mentioned the...
That's a level of personal responsibility that, we think Baen readers are prepared for.
You mentioned the science fiction community being smaller. Do you think that it's shrinking? Do you have any indications that not? And I have to make the distinction, because you have the people who go watch science fiction movies, or they go watch the Star Wars movies. They watch they watch the Mandalorian. They're not reading the books. They're not picking up the comic books. And when we were at WorldCon in 2016, when it was here in Kansas City, one of the things that we'd noticed was the demographics of who was attending that. And it raises the question, because I keep seeing the people who are interacting in various different groups and factions and whatnot. Are fans aging out? Are we getting to a point of diminishing returns where the people who are actually paying attention to published science fiction are getting older, and how are we bringing in new blood? Have there been any discussions at Baen about how to attract younger readers?
Again, that's sort of a strange demographic thing that I don't understand people making these distinctions. I've never been, you know, identified or you know, dealt with just single cohorts, right? I've always, you know, talked to people who are much older than me. I've talked to people who are much younger than me, and I don't think caring about a great story is anything that falls into a particular demographic. Now, the science fiction community, if we're talking science fiction conventions and clubs and fanzines, right. and that particular mode of being social, I think that probably is aging out. That said, the more things change, the more they stay the same, right? While traditional conventions and clubs and so on may be getting very old, if you go to a Dragon Con or if you go to some of the Comic Cons, or anime conventions, those things are huge, you know, tens of thousands of people. They're inclusive. And they're as demographically broad by any stripe as you could want to paint it, and they're very active. Are fans changing in the way that they interact with each other? Yes, yeah, they are, but that's not necessarily a bad thing.
Are the Comic Cons?
Do our books appeal to a broad demographic? I think they do, but if they don't, I also don't care.
Well, are the Comic Cons benefiting from the Hollywood aspect of things? Do you think though, because there are a lot of people there that are there to see Stephen Amell or Cary Elwes or Ming-Na Wen, and the authors in their area might or might not get a whole lot of traffic, and it has me wondering if we might need to, maybe not necessarily need to get back to doing just literary comic conventions, but there has been some discussion about doing that kind of thing. I mean, New York Comic Con has split, so you have the media con and you have the literary con. Do we need to be making that distinction in conventions, do you think, or is that overkill?
I don't think it needs to be proscriptive, right? I mean, why not both, right? We want the peanut butter and the jelly and the chocolate and the bread and everything, you know. Have small literary conventions, have big media conventions, have conventions that mingle them all together, have conventions that segregate them. There's no need to... There's no need to tell people how to do these things. Yeah. It's supposed to be fun, right? It's supposed to be fun. You know, getting together, talking about science fiction. Science fiction is supposed to be cool. Let people have fun however they're going to have fun.
I don't know. I think your expectations are a little bit high there, Toni. It's just... I mean, we're supposed to be fighting about everything, right? I mean, that's how this is supposed to go now.
Well, you know, fighting is fun too, right? You know, intellectual fighting is fun. You know, deciding, you know, which, you know, what your favorite Larry Correa series is good, you know, is fun. It's like, you know, it's got to be Grimoire. No, yeah. It's Monster Hunter International. No, it's the, you know, it's the fantasies. Or your favorite David Weber. It's like, it's got to be Arthur Harrington. Well, Path of the Fury is awesome too. Yes, it is. and that's the right answer. But, you know, it, but so, you know, fighting on that level, you know, yeah. You know, Daleks versus, what is it? The Weeping Angels, right?
Right.
I hope
right.
That's on your list of things that we don't need to see anymore. But
it actually right? So was one of those, you know,
that,
things.
That kind of fighting is awesome. We should have that kind of fighting.
Well, and Greg Cox made the point one time that that kind of debate and discussion has been going on in science fiction since the 30s. I mean, you had your true fans and you had your, you know, all of the different factions, various different times in history. But it feels like now the battle lines are a little bit different in terms of, you know, like what we were talking about earlier with the cancel culture and stuff. And I commiserate to myself how we get back to let's debate Star Wars versus Star Trek, as opposed to if you don't like The Last Jedi, you're a racist. I mean, it just, I would much rather debate Daleks versus Cybermen versus Cylons versus Klingons, as opposed to, well, you're not allowed because X.
Well, the answer is back in the 30s, there was the exact same political divide was already present, right? Mm-hmm. And it was present in fandom. It was present in 39 at the Worldcon in New York with Sam Moskowitz on one side and Fred Pohl on the other. That at that time was resolved in a way that worked for fandom. We're not seeing that resolution in science fiction fandom anymore.
Right.
And that's partly because science fiction fandom is more than just a few hundred people, right?
Sure.
That's what it was back then. I mean, you knew everybody. You could know everybody. You could visit everybody. There was some abuse of that, right? I forget what his name was, but there was a fan who would, you know, just invite himself over and stay and, you know, like, steal your shit. There were abuses of the fact that everybody knew everybody.
Yeah.
We are much, much bigger.
Yeah. Has the immediacy of social media exacerbated that, do you think? Because back in those days, you either debated something in person or you did it in the fanzines or you did it by mail. I mean, there was time between shots fired versus, you know, return fire. And nowadays it's right now. There's no cooling off period.
I think that's certainly some of it. I think the swarming aspect is also part of it. The immediacy of that. And the fact that, you're not necessarily going to meet this person in real life, right?
Yep.
So you are your online persona when these are things that you would absolutely not do if you're about to get a pop in the face, or someone was going to shun you and not invite you to lunch or something because you were just mean to them online. Yep.
But it does seem to be impacting whether or not somebody gets invited to be a guest of honor as an example, or, you know, we're going to be putting this panel together on this particular subject. Well, I'm not going to be on it if so-and-so's on it. Now, I imagine some of that has been going on since all the way back in the day.
Yes.
But only now the feuds are a little bit more public, it seems. In terms of competition, let me kind of pivot a little bit, because we mentioned Tor and Baen's out there. You've got Ballantyne, Del Rey, you've got Random House. There aren't that many imprints anymore that are publishing just straight science fiction, Orbit Books. Does the fewer number of them mean that are you all kind of getting along, or is this Knives Out? Are you all looking at each other as the distinguished competition, or are they enemies at the gate? How do you perceive each other in terms of the competitive businesses, not individual personalities, but, you know, because I imagine that there's a whole slew of people that would be, you know, neener to each other, but In terms of the businesses themselves, how they approach each other, how they market, is there a particular way of going about that?
Well, I think you'd be surprised that it's actually the opposite. Is that mostly the editors in science fiction are all fairly collegial, and with some notable exceptions, but the rest of us are. We'll raise a glass together if we meet in real life. But in terms of business strategies, I can't speak for anybody else.
Sure.
I can just say that, we at Baen do what we do. That's what we've done. We've been doing it for nearly 40 years now. We publish a particular kind of story experience that you get at Baen, and readers who fall into our logo know that they will get a consistent experience. You may not like every author that we do, but we're not gonna shock you with something that you're not going to expect. And again, you know, that story experience can be in almost any genre that is fantasy or science fiction, from time travel to alternate history to space opera to urban fantasy to epic fantasy. It doesn't have to do with genre. It has to do with the quality of the experience. So that's what we do. That's what we focus on. That's how we market. I can't really speak to how the other guys do it. No. Don't really know. Don't care. We do what we do.
But you're also not sitting there going, hey, we're better than Tor or anything like that. It's just,
we do what we do. Yeah. It's a big pie. You know, science fiction is, the potential audience for science fiction is huge. There's no reason why we can't do what we do, and they do what they do, and Del Rey does what Del Rey does, and the Star Wars novels do what the Star Wars novels do, and have all of that, happen in perfectly, collegial harmony.
Sci-Fi Snob in the chat, he says, I hear Baen and Tor get together once a month in the back alleys of New York to settle their differences with a no-holds-barred gang fight. But we don't talk about those, right?
If that were true, there would be nobody alive over there. You know that.
Well, now, I had a question on that, because not from the standpoint of the marketing, but the philosophy of Baen, the publishing philosophy. You mentioned we've done it the way we've always done it. How much of a challenge is it to maintain that mandate after all these years? When you took over as publisher, was there a significant amount of pressure to keep things just so, or it just is a natural, we're just going to keep doing the way we're doing? Do you have pressure from the outside to do things differently at any time?
Really, when Jim was alive, I was his executive editor. I came into the business at Baen Books. But when I arrived at Baen Books, my taste was already fully formed, and it jibed really, really well with Jim's. So, I certainly think that when I came on board as publisher, people were hoping that I wouldn't take things in a weird direction away from what where Baen had been when Jim was alive.
Sure.
And of course I didn't, because I liked the stuff that he was publishing, and as executive editor, I was responsible for a lot of it myself. Yeah, it's there definitely was feedback, shall we say, feedback from our readers that said, we like what Baen is doing, please don't change that. And I didn't. So we've had that continuity of editorial vision the entire time Baen has been in existence.
So you mentioned David Weber earlier. It gives me an opportunity here to say, when is the next Honor Harrington book coming in?
Ah, well, the next Honorverse book is going to be in the Call 2 series. That's not true. The next one will be his collaboration with Eric Flint, called, what the hell was it? It used to be called The Face of Evil, and now it's called something else.
Now this is the one on the, this is part of the Torch line?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, it is. So we're taking the story beyond the last Honor Harrington novel. So we are now taking the fight to the slavers, and that's going to be really, really exciting.
I'm really looking forward to that one.
Yeah,
so.
Excited about that. And that is, I think, in, I think it's fall of 21.
And David's got the new one, the new vampire one with Chris Kennedy, that has just come out.
That's from that other publisher.
Other publisher. Okay. So what else?
No, it's good. It's good too.
What else is coming out soon? What else are you working on in house? What can you tell us about?
Well, you know, we published last year Jerry Pornell's last book, Mamalukes. I just wanted, you know, it came out in the middle of the COVID season when, you know, people were hunkering down and not All going right. into bookstores. But this one is really, really, really good. So, you know, I'm going to say if you missed this Mamalukes, then you should go be seeking it out because it is a great piece of, you know, it's a planet story. It's military science fiction. It's Jerry's last solo novel. It's great. Same thing for Starborn and Godsons, which was the last of Jerry's collaborations with Larry Niven and Stephen Barnes in the Legacy of Hero series. So also a great novel, came out in April last year. This one also is really neat. Gunrunner by Larry Correa and that way. And John Brown. So you can see it's got the shiny foil cover on it. this is Larry Correa stepping out and writing a science fiction novel. He's done science fiction short stories before, but this is a whole novel length one. Sort of shades of Andre Norton, shades of Anne McCaffrey, but with maybe more guns. So,
well, with Larry's stuff, you could always expect more guns, right?
Indeed, yes.
have you had to field a lot of complaints about Larry? I mean, he's one of the more outspoken ones out on social media. You talk about that. I don't imagine that it creates a problem, but have there ever been conversations with any authors and say, hey, maybe dial it back just a little bit? Or do y'all just completely stay out of it? You do you, and we'll just publish the book.
I'm not going to comment.
Okay.
Instead, fair enough. I'm going to talk about more other books.
Yes.
So we'll do Tim that. Powers. Tim Powers, who is hardly on social media at all.
Yeah.
We're doing his urban fantasies now. So we put out his collected short fiction a couple of years ago, and he's doing great stuff for us. Tim is he had a long and checkered career with storied career. Let's put it that way. Puts out great book after great book, is one of our finest living fantasy writers. So we're really happy to be publishing him. People, you know, writers on social media, you know, they're going to be on social media. You were talking about, back, you made a comment how publishers expect writers to do their share in terms of marketing. And at Baen, we do a lot of marketing, a lot. We're on all the social media platforms, but we also do marketing to the trade. So we market directly to bookstores. We market directly to libraries. And of course, we have a website where we market directly to consumers. We don't require our writers to be marketers as well. The ones who enjoy it, for those for whom it's fun, great, you know, have at it, do you.
Yeah.
But if that's not something that you enjoy, we don't expect it, and we don't want you to do something you're not having fun with. We would much rather you just sat down, wrote the next book, and have that be your marketing contribution.
How much is
a different attitude from a lot of publishers these days.
Right. How much has the pandemic affected the press junket aspects of getting the word out about books? Because, you know, we'll get emails from PR companies, you know, this author or this, you know, this person is available for interviews. And we're doing a lot of them online, like we're doing this one. Yeah. Is online a permanent part of the mix now in terms of both publicity and maybe conventions? I mean, I've talked to a number of people talking about, you know, there are going to be people, once things open back up, there are going to be people that are not going to want to go to conventions immediately. There's going to have to be some kind of virtual track. Does it make sense that in the publicity and promotions aspects of things, virtual and online, this kind of interaction is just going to be a permanent part of the mix now?
Yeah, I think so. You know, it's one of those, if you have the capability, and we all do now, right? Everybody's got their headsets and their cameras. You know, we know how to do teleconferencing, and there's no particular reason not to, right? So if you can extend your reach and give something that the consumer wants, then why not? So yeah, we are all going to go hybrid. But right now the bookstores have not opened up yet to signings. We've tried. We want to send authors out, but the bookstores are not comfortable with it yet.
Yeah. So in all of this, in the lockdown and learning to adjust and making those changes, have you had any insights about Toni Weisskopf in the approach to how you're doing things? Has anything changed for you in terms of how you look at the job you do?
Well, I was recently at a small in-person convention, and I realized I was cussing a lot more than I usually do. And you know, I cuss a lot anyway, but not being around people that much, it made me realize I really have to watch myself. I'm very proud that I haven't done much of that here. but other than that, no, I mean, you know, what my job is to sit down and read books, right? And figure out which books are the ones that we should publish. You know, that's the heart of what it is that I do. That's the heart of what it is we do at Baen. We say, these are books you guys are going to like. Right. And then the pandemic hasn't really changed them.
Now, if I'm a new author, you know, I've self-published, I think I've got what it takes. I'm going to go approach Baen. What kind of stories are you looking for? I mean, are you guys open for submissions at this point right now? And if so, what kind of stories do you want to have? Do you have some that you're not getting enough submissions in a particular type of story? What are you looking for right now?
We are open to submission. You don't have to have an agent to submit to Baen Books. We do have an online submission process. It is not particularly easy. It's not particularly hard, but it is a test. If you can figure it out, all to the good. But just go to Baen.com and look for the FAQs, and you will find it there. We say that Baen Books publishes at the heart of science fiction and fantasy. So we're not looking for anything in particular. But if it's a genre that we've published before, then we are likely to publish again. Things that are quote unquote experimental, which is to say sad retreads of things that were not new in the 1920s, we're not particularly interested in. But if you're the next Zelazny, if you're the next Sturgeon, if you're the next Heinlein, if you're the next Bujold or McCaffrey or Norton or anybody in, you know, like that, yes, we want to hear from you. Absolutely. Yeah.
and that's both Heinlein early career and Heinlein late career, right?
Well, I think Heinlein late career is sort of one of a kind. Although I gotta say, the older I get, the more I get older Heinlein, so right. I still don't know about the number of the beast necessarily, but The Cat Who Walked the Walls, I hated when I first read it when I was a young woman, and when I reread it a few years ago, I was like, oh, huh, yeah, all right, maybe, maybe.
Have you noticed a change in what you see as being a good sellable story then as you've gotten older, as you've done this more? Have your tastes changed in terms of what you want to publish?
I don't think so, no. I try to avoid being jaded. I try to avoid being too sophisticated. For a general audience, I think I do have less patience with things that are not original, but I try to I try to err on the side of listening to what the author has to say, If the author, there's nothing new under the sun, right? That's in the Bible, okay?
Right.
Solomon, I think, King Solomon, right? This is the Old Testament. This is, humans are humans. We go back to anthropology, right? We bring it back full circle. There's human universals, right? It's how you do it. It's the voice that you as the author bring to it. It's the vision that you as the artist, give to the illustration. So I tried to leave myself open to hearing that voice and seeing that vision.
And is there any kind of story that you don't want anyone to submit, or you've got way too many in a particular category right now? Or that type, time travel is played out, dystopian future is played out. We don't need any more fill in the box.
I'm going to say pandemic. Right. I'm just going to say that, we are good on pandemic stories.
Right.
It's a little scary with Ringo, how many the things that Ringo's disasters have predicted. So if we start seeing aliens pouring through stargates, I'm not going to be at all surprised.
To Declan Finn. Declan Finn was talking about his New York stories. And he was like, these things weren't supposed to be predictive. And now he's like, well, I've got to figure out something that I absolutely know is not going to happen. Because what do you do with that kind of thing?
People dealing with pandemics are probably not going to be, that's probably going to be overdone in the next year or so.
Yeah. Well, and it's funny, I've noticed the wife and I were watching Stargate. And introducing her to the series, and there was a pandemic episode, and it strikes me now, from the perspective that we have now, just how much, all of these series that have these plague and pandemic episodes, what they get right and what they don't get in terms of what we're actually going through, and in some cases it's kind of eerie.
Yeah, I mean, you take a look at Asimov's Caves of Steel series, sub-series, and you're like, well, that kind of sucks. didn't want to be in that particular future.
Yeah.
We just published a time travel, huge, broad adventure by Weber and a new guy, Jacob Holo. And he's got they have Samuel Pepys as one of their action heroes, and as you would expect, and and of course he comes from a plague background, and this was written what 18 you know started 24 months ago eight you know finished 18 months ago, long before any of any talk of pandemics was on the horizon, and was published right in the middle of it.
All right. So, you are, how many books are you editing currently at this point? What have you got in the pipeline? How long does it take to do that sort of thing?
Well, boy, I would say I'm reading. I'm in the middle of reading about 4 or 5 books, which is too many. You shouldn't do that many at a time. bad editor. but we do 6 or 7 books a month, some of them I read in a night, and some of them take 3 or 4 weeks. It completely depends on the book and what's required.
All right, well, we're very much looking forward to the next Honor Harrington the Honorverse book here. But whatever else you've got coming out, I'm looking forward to that. And maybe we got to get on the media list and try to start doing some reviews on stuff.
That
would be good. Mm-hmm. All right, Toni Weisskopf, thanks very much for being here today. You can find out more at baenbooks.com. It's Baen. And you mentioned that Baen's on social media. Does that include all of the alt-right Istaphobe platforms like not Twitter? Where is when you say all social media?
Well, we're not on all social media. We don't have the kind of staff to be literally everywhere. But
sure.
We are on Facebook. We are on YouTube. We are on MeWe, and we I think we have a Twitter feed, but that just, it just echoes what's, you know, what we put up on Facebook.
Okay. All right. Well, we will have you back again to talk more about all the stuff going on over at Baen. And maybe at some point very soon, hopefully, knock on wood, we'll actually get to see you in person at an event soon.
Oh, that'd be great. Would love to see you.
All right. Toni Weisskopf, thanks very much for being here. And thank all of you for being here and being in the chat. And if you've got comments or questions or any kind of suggestion for guests or topics, you can leave us a comment or send us an email live from the bunker at sci-fi4me.com. Don't forget, tomorrow is our first fairy piece session with SB, the Every Fairy. She's going to be here. We'll have an open mic show where you can call in and ask your questions. We're just getting ahead of the Valentine's Day, and she's got some advice, whether she's qualified to give it or not. So be here for that at 1 p.m. Eastern tomorrow. And then Tartar Sauce on Friday at 5 p.m. Eastern. And remember, there are four lights. Thanks very much for being here, everyone.
Thanks for watching Sci-Fi for Me TV. Copyright 2021 by Flaming Dog Media, LLC. All rights reserved. No portion of this program may be retransmitted without the express written consent of Flaming Dog Media. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.